Because one of the problems I think we have today in governance is that there aren't really very many places where you can have public discussions. Right? We know that public hearings are a fraud. They don't listen to anything you say. It's only, you know, all for show. And very, very few elected representatives call meetings so you can actually have a discussion about things so people can learn from each other, which I think is the point that you're making. And that's what Jane obviously believed. You have a discussion so you can learn. You know, William Lyon Mackenzie, one of my heroes, the first mayor of Toronto, said that you really never know what you think until you involve yourself in discussion with other people. And that's when you find out what you actually think, when your ideas are bouncing off other people. We don't have places where that can happen anymore, which is a bit of a problem. And maybe we're going to have to start to figure out, we have to start to create those, and that would be something that Jane, I think, would be very happy with.
Heretical here, and this harkens back to almost 30 years ago when I was a younger City Hall reporter covering your administration, our agriculture, and Jane Jacobs was making a point at a council meeting, and I had a chat with one of your, who shall remain nameless, advisors at the time, who said to me, Jane Jacobs is wrong on this. She may be sainted, but she's wrong. Was Jane Jacobs wrong about anything that we're talking about? We have the benefit of 50 years of hindsight here with death and life. Was she wrong about anything in hindsight? All right, I got to take the mic from Barb Hall and start off on that.
Well, the only thing I remember was that in her book, she said, we've got a problem because buildings are getting higher, so they've got elevators. And there's vandalism in elevators. What was her solution to this? Elevator attendants. No, it didn't work. I don't know if any, I can't remember what my assistant was thinking of. And I think she and I did not agree on everything. But I think we had much the same intentions in mind. I can remember, I think, an interesting debate with her. It was on a boat. We were crisscrossing the harbor, and we had a guest. It was the Queen of the Netherlands, Queen Beatrix. And the Queen liked to get into BT dialogue, substantive discussion. And she did well. Of course, she would invite the mayor, that's me. But mayors always say, oh, my city's the greatest, and all that sort of stuff. She probably figured that's what she was going to get from me. She invited Jacobs as well, so there were the two of us, back and forth, going across the waterfront, debating, is that building, that area, whatever, right for the city. But I think we had some disagreements. Well, we had one. When I ran for mayor, she supported Jones. But other than that, I think we had very substantive agreement, and I think the principles she has taught are things that I think have done very well for our city.
Barbara, what was she wrong about?
She was very angry at me because I supported the fixed link to the Island Airport.
Now, folks, we have a rule with these things. You're allowed to heckle, but only if it's witty. Bullying is not witty.
I keep a list of all the people who were mad at me, who I bump into having cafe au lait at the Porter I just smile.
Baby Crowley? Oh, sorry. I was well, on a couple of things, yeah. First of all, she wrote a book on sovereignty association. You ever read that one? Good book. And I think she demonstrated her lack of understanding of Canadian history and Canadian politics and the way it works. I think it was a great mistake, and the book was not very helpful.
She was pro-sovereignty association?
Yes. Yes. No, and I think she wrote, yes. Yes.
She thought that Montreal would be much better off if it was not under the federal government, but under a Quebecois government. And to that extent, that is why she thought that separation was a useful thing. And she used the example of Norway separating from Sweden in 1905, and how, in fact, Oslo didn't collapse when that happened. Now, I think it's a very interesting book. It's been reprinted recently.
Yeah, I know that. Right. So I thought she was wrong there. We can pick up another program on that. I think, quite frankly, too, and I'm not sure it's the right forum for this, but I think she was not very strong-footed on the issue of the regional approach that took on the GTA, on the Golden Horseshoe, or whatever it became. The notion that somehow you create city-states was something I never caught on to. I think that was somehow an attempt to try and create a municipality out of a city. And cities expand, and they need to have different limits. Governments have to have boundaries and borders. But cities need to expand, and they need to have different boundaries and different borders for different things. And so I felt that her sense that somehow you need to create a government for a city-state was going to be, was a limiting thing to the regional expansion of the city.
John, just before you go,
she was a bit wrong-headed about it. I think the thing she was a bit wrong-headed about was the role of government in decision-making. I mean, I thought she described it well in systems of survival, but in real life, she really seemed to have problems with big government and always assumed it could never do the right thing. And I think that was a problem. I mean, Tony Judd's book, Ill Fares the Land, is a very strong case for the positive role of government, doing the right things. And I think Jane was very worried about that. She liked small government, that was okay. But when you got into big government, she seemed to think, well, this is a big problem. And I think she was a bit wrong on that. Okay.
Okay, I know this is a Canadian audience and nobody wants to go first. But somebody out there is going to have to be brave to get this thing started. There we go.
Transportation. And it seems to be the big issue in this city still. I'm just wondering...
Just wondering where we went so wrong. I know Mr. Sewell used to ride a bike to work, and that was quite a while ago, and it was starting to become something that was accepted. We've seen our city digress, shall I say.
Okay.
And I'm just wondering what you think the main reason this part of our progression has taken so long and taken such a wrong turn.
John, you want to start? Where did it go off the rails? No pun intended.
Well, I mean, let's face it, we have not been willing to invest in public transit. It costs a lot of money. The city doesn't have the money to do it on its own. It needs the provincial government. This is one of the great problems that Jane talked about the need for cities to be relatively self-funding to build things. The provincial government literally has had very little interest in the last 20 years in building serious rapid transit. In fact, as we know, the national government feels the same way. I mean, if there's anything we need, it's high-speed rail between here and Montreal and so forth. But in fact, we have not had governments willing to put that money in. And I don't believe that any asking by the city of the provincial or federal governments is going to get us that money. I believe the only way we're going to get it is by actually having our own tax sources to allow us to raise enough money here to do it. But I think that's the problem. It's the transportation dollars and those other levels of government saying, hey, not interested.
On the transportation relationship to problems, in our time, we got 50% of right, 50% on operating, and 75% on capital. I mean, so we were doing well, but we had a tremendous provincial support. 50% on operating, 75% on capital. I don't know if what is it today?
Oh, it's
no one knows. But that was a formula that the PTC had. So that made all the difference in terms of being able to move forward in an orderly way on the expansion of the PTC.
Is there a mic down there anymore? No.
Okay. Oh, there's a mic down there.
want to do to set about the need to have new funding arrangements with respect to transit and a lot of other things as well. Because the fiscal imbalance in this country is not really between the federal and provincial governments, it's between those two governments and the municipal level of government, which has really not enough to be able to do the kind of things we expect of them. But there's also something here that's, I think, disturbing at the city level itself. We had this plan called Transit City. I didn't think it was a perfect plan, but on the other hand, it was a plan that was going to move us forward and start to deal with the transportation issues we have, the public transit issues that we have in the city. Well, all of a sudden, we're back to square one, so it seems. We're back to reinventing the wheel. You can't make progress if you're continually going to go back and revisit all of these things. The same might be happening on the waterfront, too. So I think it's a shame that the city doesn't stick to the plan that it adopted and would have moved this forward. Urban transportation, urban transit in Toronto is in bad shape. And it's about to get worse because they're about to cut down on the service levels. That is absolutely the wrong direction to go. We've got too much congestion in this city, and we're not doing enough in terms of public transit to get it solved. But you can't do it. You keep changing the plan all the time.
Perfect.
The former speaker said political will or lack of is a big issue. The funding formula is a big issue. I don't know the exact numbers, but I think Toronto has the highest percentage of funding coming from the fare box of any transit system in North America. And for many years, the TTC was the leading example. I think another problem which influences the funding formula and political will is what we've let become the language or the culture around government. That government is bad, that taxes are bad, that we should be able to have services and more services, but not pay for them. That public servants and people who provide services and make a decent wage are all ripping us off and should be gotten rid of. So a real anti-government culture, which influences, I think, the lack of political will. People are frightened to put forward the kinds of capital expenditures that are required for sustainable transportation in our region.